Hey, thank you, John. It is a pleasure to be here to discuss this very important topic with you. Today's focus is dementia and caregiving for Japanese American elders and their families. My intention is to explore three areas. One is the unique characteristics and historical experiences of Japanese Americans today. Second is why they might believe and behave as they do when it comes to dementia and mental health issues. And finally, to think about some interventions and strategies to enhance the quality of life of JA families dealing with dementia. Before I begin, I would like to express my appreciation to several colleagues for their assistance with this presentation. They are, first of all, the staff at UIKAI in San Jose. That's the Japanese American Community Senior Services Organization. They include Barbara Masterson, the wellness nurse, Yuko Hanaishi and Emi Nagai, the care managers, and former director Wes Mukoyama. I would also like to acknowledge Dr. Kelly Takagi, formerly of the Stanford VA Alzheimer's Center, and Dr. Dolores Gallagher-Thompson, and others at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center. The first part of this presentation is on the background and the history of Japanese Americans in the United States. Based on the data in the 2004 census, there are currently about 790,000 Japanese Americans in the U.S. overall. Approximately 240,500 individuals are over the age of 55, and two-thirds are American-born. One distinguishing feature is their within-group diversity, in spite of stereotypical images of Japanese Americans as a model minority. That model minority image was that they are clean, well-behaved, educated, don't complain or cause any trouble, and pay their bills on time. However, differences are seen in socioeconomic status. For example, some have achieved marked financial success, while others may live in poverty, particularly older Japanese American women. These differences depend on gender, age, generation, living arrangements, and other factors. One other factor is religion. Japanese Americans practice many different religions, like mainstream populations. Another factor is geographic differences. For example, Japanese Americans in Hawaii tend to be more aggressive and assertive because they did not face the same degree of racial and ethnic discrimination as their mainland counterparts. There are also urban and rural differences. So again, Japanese Americans are a very diverse population. Older Japanese Americans comprise one of the smallest groups of elders among Asian Pacific Islander American populations due to their length of time in this country and decreasing numbers of recent immigrants. As mentioned previously, they have been in the United States for a long time. The first immigrants arrived in the 1860s as laborers working on the Hawaiian plantations, or as railroad workers, miners, or farm laborers on the mainland farms. In 1882, because of the Chinese Exclusion Act, there was an increased demand for Japanese laborers. So from 1910 to 1920, over 70,000 workers arrived from Japan. During this same time period, there was a huge influx of women who came from Japan, first as proxy or picture brides. The number swelled from 410 married women in 1900 to over 22,000 women in 1920, and thus the growth of Japanese American family units had begun. Another unique historical feature was the establishment of Japantowns, or Nihonmachis. These distinct community centers were developed to meet the needs of early immigrant laborers and their families. Nihonmachis were cultural, social, and religious centers, And while there were large numbers of Japan towns in the early 1900s, only three remain in the United States today. They're located in San Francisco, Los Angeles, and San Jose, California. Currently, most Japanese Americans live on the United States West Coast and Hawaii. The early Japanese immigrants had unique generational identities. This concept was so important that distinct names were given for each generation in the United States. Issei were the first generation immigrants from Japan, pioneers who are now almost gone, and those who are left are frequently age 100 and older. Nisei are the second generation children of the Issei and today's elders. Kibei are Nisei who were educated in Japan when they were younger and who later returned to the United States to live. So many of them are primarily Japanese speaking. Sansei are the third generation and today's caregivers. I am a Sansei. Yonsei and Gosei are the fourth and fifth generations and the future caregivers. Other groups include a category known as war brides or Japanese women who married U.S. servicemen. For the most part, very little is known about this cohort, but these women tended to maintain their Japanese language and traditions, and over 30,000 women are thought to be in this category. Shin Issei are the newcomers. They are businessmen and their families who are in the United States temporarily, and their numbers are also unknown because they go back and forth. Nikkei is a relatively new term coined in the 1980s, which represents all Japanese Americans of all generations. Each generation possesses unique characteristics and traits that distinguish them from one another. These photographs represent the darkest side of Japanese American history. The early Issei and their families faced many hardships. They were denied the right to become U.S. citizens. They could not purchase homes or own land, so property ownership was placed in the name of children or Caucasian friends. They could not marry outside of their race due to anti-miscegenation laws. Some attended segregated schools, especially in the Japantowns, and many college-educated Nisei could not find work except on farms, fruit stands, and menial labor, or as many women ended up as secretaries or clerks. By far the most significant event to impact current Nikkei families occurred during World War II, and this pivotal experience was something that nearly all Japanese American families have in common. Following the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, there were rumors of sabotage and fear of Japanese Americans as spies or yellow peril. In 1942, Executive Order 9066 gave 120,000 persons of Japanese descent on the West Coast only a few days to leave their homes for evacuation centers, which were really stables at racetracks. The majority of these detainees were U.S. citizens, second generation children. They were then sent to 10 relocation centers throughout the United States, which was really a euphemism for concentration camps. The reason given by the government was they were sent there for their own protection, because the U.S. was at war with Japan. Families were allowed to take only what they could carry, forcing them to sell off or abandon all property and personal possessions. And these pictures depict some of those things. Here you see the Japanese Order 9066. I'm trying to negotiate this here. Right here is the Order 9066. Here is the grandfather and his grandchildren with identification. Whoops. Sorry. I had the wrong thing. Maybe I won't use the pointer. I'll just try to. So you have the grandfather with children and his grandchildren with identification tags, much like baggage, waiting for a train to take them to camp. The next picture is Tule Lake, one of the 10 camps of hastily constructed barracks located in a barren desert wasteland on the California-Oregon border, and my own parents were sent to Tule Lake. You see armed guards and watchtowers that surround the camps in the next photograph. And below that, you see a family outside one of the barracks, trying to maintain a sense of normalcy for the sake of their children. The next photo shows a representative of the 442 Regimental Combat Team and the 100th Battalion. These two units were composed of volunteer soldiers from Hawaii and the U.S. camps, and ironically, they were the most highly decorated unit of the European front during World War II, and they also sustained enormously incredible casualty numbers. So discrimination and anti-Japanese sentiment was faced by evacuees during the resettlement period as well, when they were released from the camps. That's the last two pictures. The camp experience shaped many of the beliefs and the behaviors of Japanese American elders and their descendants today. Traditional Japanese families, or Japanese American families, have roots in Meiji-era Confucian teachings that were practiced in Japan during the reign of the Emperor Meiji. These include a deep respect for elders, particularly parents and grandparents. The second one is in the United States. We focus on individual rights and autonomy. But traditional Japanese society held that family needs and desires are paramount. What is best for the family is not necessarily what the individual is best for the individual. And frequently you hear elders say they do not want to be a burden on their family because of this belief. So it's the family and emphasis versus individual focus. Deference to authority is another value. Not questioning or not challenging authority, such as doctors or nurses or teachers, because it is thought to be disrespectful. In U.S. values, people confront others when there's a problem or a disagreement arises. But Japanese Americans were taught to avoid conflict and confrontation and to deal with sensitive problems quietly, if at all. So sometimes denial was a solution. Indirect communication is another value. In the U.S., we are encouraged to speak out and to ask for assistance. But Nikkei believe in intuitive interpersonal communication. That is, people should be able to anticipate needs and preferences without someone having to articulate them. So, for example, parents are not overtly affectionate because Japanese children know that they are loved. Or another example, adult children should know what older parents expect and need. This has important implications for end-of-life decision-making or financial planning. Privacy and confidentiality are important because negative information or bad news within the family, such as mental illness, or discussing a family matter with an outsider may cause shame or loss of face to the family. Traditional Japanese families are also patriarchal or male-dominated. Especially, there's a special respect for oldest sons. So this has decision-making implications. However, the research has shown the oldest son may have responsibility caring for parents. The wives do all the hands-on care, which is not dissimilar to our mainstream caregivers. Some specific terms, Japanese terms, also reflect the Japanese values and beliefs. Oyakoko refers to filial piety, or a sense of duty and reciprocity between children and parents. This very deep sense of respect means that it is the adult child's duty and responsibility to care for their parents, no matter what. Shikataganai is another word. It's a sense of fatalism, or it cannot be helped, or nothing can be done. Sometimes it is reflected in not complaining about pain, or not seeking needed services or assistance, because it is fate. Gaman is a stoicism in adverse situations, like not complaining about pain or stress or problems, because the belief that withstanding these challenges builds character. Haji is a sense of shame which reflects onto the family, such as the stigma of mental health or dementia problems, or disabilities, or just being different. And Enyo is a refusal of assistance to avoid being a bother or a burden to a family member or others. So my question to all of you, and something to think about during the rest of this presentation, is if you are a health or social service provider, what are the implications in providing services based on this information? Next, we will briefly discuss some issues in the assessment of dementia among Japanese American families. The research on Nikkei and dementia is extremely sparse, and they were actually discussed in a little more detail in Dr. Guenyo's presentation during the first webinar. Most of what we know is based on the findings of two major longitudinal studies. The first is the HAAS, or the Honolulu Asian Aging Study, of approximately 3,700 Japanese-American men. It began in 1965 to study risk factors for cardiovascular diseases and was then expanded to include neurodegenerative diseases in men born between 1900 and 1919. And there is now some data on women available. The KAME project was based in Seattle, Washington, and started in 1992 and ended in 2001. Kame means turtle, and that population was about almost 2,000 men and women of Japanese descent, and it was originally a cross-cultural study of Alzheimer's disease and prevalence incidence rates and vascular dementia among Japanese in Japan, Hawaii, and Seattle, and the latest data included caregiving issues. Sadly, some places where data could have been collected have been closed. The Stanford VA Alzheimer's Disease Center closed in 2009 due to a lack of state funds, and the NIA-funded Alzheimer's Center closed in 2006. So again, there is relatively little research available. Prevalence rates for dementia, as discussed by Dr. Yeo, reported rates similar to whites in both the Honolulu study and the Kame study. Other smaller studies, mostly in Hawaii, have examined perceptions of dementia among Nikkei. For example, dementia was perceived as normal aging, but abnormal behaviors could be attributed to being crazy or insane, and people who exhibited some of these were labeled as kichigai, which means crazy or insane. In Hawaii, it was discovered that dementia in males was more difficult to diagnose. Japanese American males were able to hide their cognitive deficits longer than females because women had more tasks and roles that required higher functioning cognitive abilities, which made detection much easier. Due to shikataganai and gaman, Nikkei women tend to accept and adapt to caregiver stressors more than their mainstream caregiver counterparts. But it was found that they still need and can benefit from caregiver resources and assistance. Others have shown there is a reluctance to report symptoms of dementia by elders and their families out of fear that these symptoms are a result of genetic defects, of punishment or karma, or poor family care and attention. Thus, dementia and Alzheimer's disease are considered a silent epidemic among Japanese Americans due to failure to recognize and report early cognitive and behavioral changes. And they found that many times the families waited for a crisis before they would seek help. Language issues also play a large role in the assessment of dementias among Nikkei elders. There is a need for culturally relevant assessment instruments for use in the Japanese-speaking community. That's most important for monolingual non-English-speaking elders, such as Kibe or the war brides or newcomers. But it is not enough to simply translate words from the original English versions. Instruments must also be culturally relevant and appropriate. And there is also one other consideration that is very important. We must also consider the health literacy levels of the instruments and the information. And that is that the levels of understanding among the patients should be assessed, and the presentation of information by healthcare providers. For your information, the COMET project translated all the instruments listed on this slide. I won't read them all, but there is information available. And the investigators reported that satisfactory equivalence was achieved between the English and the Japanese. The final section of this presentation will address issues of working with family caregivers. In your handouts, you have a case example, and it's rather lengthy, so I hadn't planned on really going through it in detail. It's taken from the book Ethnicity and the Dementias, second edition. And because it's long, I will not discuss it in detail now, but please look for the following issues and examples as you go through your handout. This case illustrates several intergenerational Nikkei family issues when an elder suffers from dementia. Here you will see a multiracial Japanese-American family caring for parents with dementia and Alzheimer's disease. You will encounter caregiver challenges that arise within Nikkei families. There will be cultural issues that affect the use of mental health services. This case addresses Japanese family values and also family dynamics. So it's a very, very complex, very rich case. If you have any questions or wish to discuss the case in more detail, please feel free to contact me directly. And I just realized this morning I did not give you my contact information, but you can contact John DiMario, and he will give you my email address or my telephone number. So please feel free to call me. The following slides reveal some of the complex challenges that are encountered by traditional Japanese-American caregivers of individuals with dementia. Now let's go back a little bit and think about the values and attitudes that we talked about earlier. So just to reiterate, in very traditional Nikkei families, traditional beliefs mandate that mental health problems are a stigma and should not be discussed outside the family. They mandate that because of oyakoko, Nikkei family caregivers have a duty and an obligation to care for their parents no matter how difficult. Due to a belief in family privacy, problems with a family member should be solved within the family. And there should be a reluctance to seek help and to report embarrassing, shameful, or troublesome symptoms or behaviors to outsiders. But what you will see in the next slide depicts some different trends that we are seeing. The next generation trends. We have to remember that the Nikkei, the Japanese Americans, are the most acculturated and assimilated of all of the Asian Pacific Islander American subgroups. They are primarily English speaking now, the elders especially. Many younger generations, in fact, cannot speak or understand any Japanese. Outmarriage rates exceed 50%, which is resulting in a dilution of traditional Japanese American values and beliefs. We are finding shifts in what Nikkei parents expect from their adult children, and changes in expectations for family care from these Nikkei parents. And as in mainstream populations, there are changes in women's roles and a growing acceptance of outside services. The current trend for sansei caregivers, based on data from the Kame Project, reveal the following. And remember that most sansei were born during World War II or after the camp experience, like myself. So what we are seeing from the sansei caregivers is there is more limited family elder care due to increasing employment and other demands. We see that their preferences are for blended rather than all Japanese services and providers. We see a greater openness to outside assistance, resulting in increasing demands for services and programs for dementia and Alzheimer's disease from other types of providers. And we also see changing attitudes towards institutionalization. That is, there's a greater acceptance found in areas where Japanese-specific skilled nursing facilities exist. And for your information, there actually are nursing homes that are ethnic-specific, particularly Japanese-American-specific, in Los Angeles. There's two, one in Boyle Heights of Los Angeles and one in Gardena. There's one in Seattle, Washington, and also one in Sacramento. Based on all this information, here are some suggestions for providers working with Nikkei family caregivers. First and foremost, acknowledge that the Japanese American population is very diverse, that one size fits all services are not appropriate, and that services cannot be based on different, on assumptions, particularly if you're dealing with the different generations of elders. It's important to be sensitive and knowledgeable about the past experiences of Nikkei families, particularly some wariness toward government systems and bureaucracies. It's important to train providers about the importance of establishing rapport and trust, to increasing awareness about language and food preferences where they exist, about protocols for family decision-making. Is there an older son who makes the decisions, or maybe someone who is a healthcare provider? And there are other unique traits that make a difference in the perceived quality of services provided. And it's also very important to educate Nikkei caregivers about dementia and Alzheimer's disease and available support care and services and resources, and to encourage them to seek assessment and evaluation where they are available, if those services are available. I wanted to spend just a little bit of time telling you about a unique Japanese American community model. It's something that I have studied over the years a little bit, and it's something that I think other groups might have tried to model themselves in some respects, or maybe the Japanese American modeled it after other groups. But in the United States, mostly on the West Coast, there are communities of Japanese Americans where there are networks of JA services. For example, the San Francisco Bay Area, Seattle, Sacramento, Los Angeles, somewhat in the Central Valley of California, Chicago, and some other places. Well, what is there? There's an array of culturally appropriate Japanese-specific services. But the combinations vary by location. And that is to say, there are more services in the larger cities or where there are larger concentrations of Japanese Americans. These services range from senior centers to adult daycare programs to case management to nutrition programs and even to long-term care facilities. But again, they differ by geographic area, location, and population size. In all areas, I've found that caregiver support groups are gaining widespread support and interest. One example would be UIKai in San Jose, the Japanese Senior Center. They have a caregiver support group that deals not with just only with people with dementia, but other caregivers as well. And they have provided, over the course of their sessions, classes on caregiver skills building. So classes on how to cope with stress, how to reduce stress, problem solving, all of these different kinds of issues that caregivers come across. But it's very important to note that in this model, former care that is provided by the Japanese American service providers is considered an extension of family care. So to connect it back to the value of having the adult children take care of their own families, these services are seen by the younger generations as an extension of that family care. Other recommendations are very similar to what we recommend for other populations. But in terms of public policies, there needs to be increased availability of family resources, whether they be for financial or hands-on assistance or mental health services, to help Nikkei caregivers and their families. We need to develop educational materials in varying formats that are written, videos, audio, etc., and that are at different levels and that are in the Japanese languages, if necessary. In terms of research, there's a need to develop culturally appropriate assessment tools for persons with dementia and Alzheimer's disease, as well as for caregivers, and particularly non-English speaking elders and their caregivers. And somewhere we need to reestablish and refund the Alzheimer's Disease Assessment Centers that study dementia in Japanese American populations, particularly if we know that there is a possibility of an impending hidden epidemic. So in conclusion, I'd like to read to you this slide. Japanese Americans are the most assimilated of all Asian Pacific Islander populations. However, many elders and their caregivers maintain traditional Japanese language, customs, beliefs, and values. So cultural factors play a significant role in delivering appropriate care to Nikkei elders with dementia and contribute to a better quality of life for caregivers and their loved ones. Throughout this presentation, two symbols have appeared that represent the characteristics of the Nikkei as a group, I think. These symbols are one, the cranes, and cranes represent long life in Japan. People in Japan, as you probably know, are the longest lived in the world. So long life, health, and vitality is what I've hoped to depict here on these slides. The other symbol is bamboo. And bamboo, because like the Japanese American people, bamboo is strong, it's resilient, and it's capable of bending with the winds of adversity without breaking. So I think I went at a pretty fast clip. I hope you were able to understand what I was trying to impart. So thank you very much for your presence and your attention today, and I am open for any questions that you may have.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Hikoyeda. Yes, this is John DeMario, the host of the webinar. And I just want to invite everyone to post any questions that they have right now. We can respond to them. I do see one that just came in, and we can respond to that right now. But if you need help using this feature, it's in the lower left part of the screen. There's a button that says Everyone to Everyone, and right above it is a little rectangular white box. And you can type your question into that little rectangular box and hit enter, or click on that little enter key, a return key on the right of it. And that will send the message over to everybody who's participating today, including myself, and I'll be able to read it off to the doctor. All right, so our first question is asking about to please comment on the collaborative effort between Japanese American researchers in dementia studies. I don't know if there's anything you want to respond to that.
Well, I don't know a lot about, and I'm assuming you mean the research that's being done in Japan. I don't know a lot about the specific research in Japan or the researchers themselves. I do know that there has been very close collaboration with Japan for both the Haas study and the Kame project. That they have published a lot of publications together, they've shared data, and that they have worked very closely to share data and findings. But I'm afraid that's the extent. I'm more familiar with the work that is done here. And one of the interesting things I think is that, particularly in the Kame project, that most of the researchers here in Seattle were white and not Japanese. So I'm not sure if there was just not Japanese researchers or what. And it's interesting because in a lot of studies of different ethnic populations, different ethnic elders, the primary researchers, the primary investigators are mainstream white investigators and not from those different ethnic groups. So I hope that answers. Yes, there has been historically tension between the Korean and the Japanese populations. Because the Japanese were very imperialistic and had, tried to take over Korea many times, and so there were a lot of Korean elders, particularly who were under Japanese rule, and there were also many Korean elders who lived in Japan, and who do speak Japanese, and I'm not sure about whether or not there should be intervention. I suppose it depends on the type of contact and the type of relationships And the reason for the dissension, as I said, I'm a sansei. I'm a third generation Japanese American, so I'm not all that familiar with what went on. I know that I met a third generation Korean student when I was at UCLA, and one of the things she told me when I first met her that never occurred to me, she said, "I just want you to know that I harbor no ill will against you because you're Japanese American." So that was a very interesting comment because I really didn't know that much about the friction and the tension until I had moved to California. I think you have to play it by ear. And I don't know, it's sort of a, it's a very, I would say it's a very, probably a very sticky topic with some people. Let's see. Yeah, I hope we answered that question. If not, please please ask again. Let's see. Let's see. Thank you. I think it's, I'm sorry, I'm reading the questions. Okay, Dr. McBride is asking, I wonder if the friction is observed between a Japanese American provider and a Korean patient. That's very possible. That's very possible. And I think it's a complex issue because I think it involves, if you have providers who are from different ethnic populations, whether they're Asian or African American or Hispanic or what have you, and you do have those racial tensions, those ethnic and racial tensions, I think it's a matter of education, of trying to reach some kind of an understanding of what both sides of the, you know, both sides of the issues were or are. Of course, if you're working with someone with a dementia, that's probably not possible. But I think it is an educational issue. Let's see. Maybe if that's the last question, then maybe we should pull up the case because we do have a few minutes that we could discuss it. So basically, in this case study, you have a situation where there is a Nikkei male who is married to a Chinese woman, a second generation Chinese American woman. And so she has many of these Confucian values as well, such as, you know, wanting, being willing to live next in an extended family. She has very great respect for parents and grandparents. And what the situation is that the her husband's parents, the Kibei Nisei, so a man who was raised in Japan, and the mother-in-law, his mother, who was raised in Japan, have come to live with them. And they have found that there's a lot of tension because the father seems to be very critical of his daughter-in-law. He's also exhibiting some signs, some symptoms of having dementia. And he is a caregiver himself for his wife, who has some type of a dementia, possibly an Alzheimer's disease. And so what happens is the wife shows up at the senior center one day, and she's in tears and she looks very distraught. And she reveals to one of the senior center care managers that she's under all this caregiver tension and stress at home because she's constantly criticized by her Kibei Nisei father-in-law. Mother-in-law has a dementia. Her husband, who is the second son, does not appear to be very supportive of her in terms of supporting her in, rather than taking the side of the parents. Or taking her side. And so what finally happens is she starts going for individual counseling. And then soon after that, her husband joins her for counseling. And he admits that he felt the tension between his wife and his father, but he felt helpless in trying to mediate. He talked to his father, but the father didn't listen. And the sessions between the two of them turn out to be quite successful. And actually, they're able to convince the father-in-law to also join in the family counseling. And at one point, the entire family goes. There's all of them, including two young children. Eventually, the grandmother, Bachan, is assigned a Japanese-speaking case manager. And it becomes very clear that there's lots of conflicts within the family. They find out that Ji-chan, the grandfather, actually has some borderline personality issues, some psychological issues, and that he had some issues with his mother, who he felt abandoned him in Japan, and he has increasing paranoia and other problems. There's a cultural difference here between the Japanese father-in-law and his Chinese-American daughter-in-law. There's intergenerational differences between the father and the son. And what ensues is counseling that strengthens the bonds between the son and the daughter-in-law. They learn to respect Ji-chan's pride and to acknowledge his fear of losing control of his memory. Finally, his independence due to his increasing symptoms of dementia. And the son comes to the realization where he says, I realize that my father will not change, and I will have to learn to cope with that, which was thought to be a very profound understanding. He realizes that the responsibility of taking care of his parents is his, and that he wants his children to have the experience of living in an extended family. And his wife comes to appreciate her husband's support much more. So you can see this is a very complex case, but it's actually a very real case. We had permission to publish this case. So I'm open to any questions or comments you might have about this. And let's see that there is one. What strategies would be helpful in getting the elder Ji-chan to the counseling session, since this may be shameful to him? I think telling him, if it was my understanding that the son and the people at the senior center had told him that there was, you know, some stress in the household, and they really wanted to make this work. And so they encouraged him to get involved in some of the activities, and then he gradually did kind of decide to go for the counseling, because he did realize that there was a lot of stress and tension in that household. But it wasn't easy, and it wasn't done in a very short period of time. It was over a period of time. Any other questions or comments? And you're right. The last question, you are right. It was, I think it was difficult for him to acknowledge that they might need some help, outside help.
Great. Well, I like to think, okay, thank I think we're all, I think we've answered the questions. If there's any more, we can take those now. But in the meantime, we'd like to point you to our closing survey or questionnaire for the webinar. If you could, I'll pull up that link in a second here, and you'll be able to connect and give feedback based on what you thought about the session today. And oops, sorry. Okay, So some of you might see a new window actually open up on your computer screen. Sometimes it doesn't appear in the front. You have to go look on your behind the current window to find the survey, but it should pop up somewhere, and you can fill that out. If you don't see it, let me know, and we'll definitely send it to you by email as well, so you'll have a chance to fill that out then. It looks like we don't have any more questions for today's presentation, so I think we'll conclude right now. I'd like to thank Dr. Hikayeda and for presenting today, and I'd also like to thank you, most importantly, for attending and participating. Oh, I'm sorry. There is one couple questions here. One more question that came through. Let me just pull up your screen here. I'll read it out loud, but let's see here. There's someone asking for suggestions on how to encourage a Japanese American to communicate. She's an ombudsman, and so yeah. Oops. Oh, your mouse not working. I'm sorry. Yeah, but you can just there it is. Yeah. Okay. It's just disappeared. Sorry. Oh, the talk. I can do that. I'll do that for you. One moment. There you go. Got it.
Can you hear me?
Let's see. Are there suggestions on how to encourage Japanese Americans to communicate? Well, I think that the current cohort of elders, the Nisei, it is more difficult to get them to communicate, and it is a big issue. But how can you encourage them? Well, I think it depends on the circumstances. You may need to go through someone else, like their children, who might ask them to participate or to give more information, that kind of thing. As an ombudsman, I'm guessing that you have a situation of elder abuse. And I think that would be very, very difficult because the elders would be very, very opposed to reporting their adult children. They would lose face. It would be a reflection on their upbringing if they have an adult child who is abusing them. So that would be something that would be very, very difficult. And also there would be the fear that if you took away their caregiver, that who would take care of them? It would take a number of other people, I think, to get involved. Other professionals, but in particular, to try to convince them. But yeah, as an ombudsperson, I've actually asked myself that question. What do you do if you are an ombudsman and someone reports elder abuse in a Japanese American family?